This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to this online worship of Wayside Presbyterian Church of Erie, Pennsylvania. I'm James Bernhardt, Senior Pastor. Here on this third Sunday of Lent, we encounter Jesus, in whose life God transforms us from spectators to participants in his risen life in the world. We come this day in worship to the Lord's table, where all are welcome. Dispersed as we continue to be, we may share communion elements where we are, and you may wish to gather those as we begin worship. Christ's table is broad, and there is room for all who come seeking him to gather there. Christ's table is as broad as the grace and welcome of God, which invites you, wherever you find yourself, in your journey of life and faith today, for you are one whom God loves, in whom God delights. Friends, be who you are and be welcome here. Thanks be to God for your outpouring of generosity in support of the Easter dinner drive with our mission partners, West Mill Creek Food Pantry. The goal of $10 per family for 120 families has exceeded $1,000 on our way to the goal of $1,200 by March 14th. If you wish to give, please send a check payable to Wayside with Easter ham in the memo, or visit the church website giving portal under Mission Giving and the subfund West Mill Creek Food Pantry. Stay up to date with pandemic era church goings on with the Wayside weekly email each Monday and through contacts throughout the week. This week, a letter is coming to you from the session of Wayside about the coming weeks and plans for gradual reopening of Wayside, as well as the schedules for Holy Week. Each day, thanks be to God, we hear about more people being vaccinated against the coronavirus, though not as swiftly or as many as we might hope. Your patience during these months and the living out of church life in ways that respond to Christ's call to be good neighbors is testimony to your faithfulness and to God's love. In time, we hope to reflect on this era for how God's love sustained us, light in darkness, hope in despair, peace within tumultuous days. If you are someone who has struggled to find a vaccine, I hope you will contact me or the church office, and there may be ways that we can network you with someone who can provide. And now, let us praise the God of all salvation. Thank you.
God has told you, O mortal, what is good and what the Lord requires of you, to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Let us draw near to the Holy One so that we may learn and walk in goodness. Let us worship God. Please join me in the call to worship, responding with the bold words on your screen. What is the first and greatest commandment? Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. What is the second commandment like it? You shall love your neighbor as yourself. What does this mean? Love is fulfilling of the law. To what does the law call us? To a life of faith unfolding and working through love. Let us pray. Gracious God, through your law, the prophets, and in Jesus Christ, you reveal your gracious purposes for living as your beloved community. Open our eyes to the ways in which your grace surrounds us, and conform our lives and our world to the love you have shown us through Christ our Savior. Amen. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly beloved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as an offering and a sacrifice to God. Knowing the ways in which we fall short of God's purposes, let us offer up our confessions to the Lord, that we may rediscover God's love and recommit ourselves to lives of love. Let us pray. Loving God, who delivers us through the wilderness, we confess our lack of trust in you. You gave commandments to show how we may live in thriving relationships with you and with each other. But we have treated your laws as burdens, followed our own desires, and turned our backs on you and on each other. Forgive us for treating you as a bother and other people's problems. Redeem us to trust your leading, that we may live as people of love and justice as you have shown, through Christ our Lord. Amen. If you, O Lord, kept a record of inequities, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, that you may be honored. Hope in the Lord, for with God there is steadfast love and great power to redeem. Believe the good news that through Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Amen.
So, I'm sorry. Those are important words that we say when we've done something to hurt someone or when we've done the wrong thing. They're so important, but they can be really hard to say. So why is it hard to say, I'm sorry? Maybe you're really embarrassed. We don't want to look bad, and so it's easy to not deal with our mistakes or admit them. In that moment, maybe we feel like the only person in the world who makes those kinds of mistakes. So again, we avoid it. We don't admit it. Or maybe you're afraid that if you apologize, if you admit what you did, that the other person, maybe a parent, or maybe a friend, maybe a neighbor, that maybe they're not going to like you anymore. That's a lot of pressure. But here's the thing. You're not the only one who makes mistakes. I do. We all do. We all end up doing stupid, mean, or thoughtless, even cruel things. We all make mistakes, and we can all do better, but we have to be honest and admit it in order to be better. Also, admitting a wrong doesn't make you a bad person or someone undeserving of love. We should talk about how we do bad things from time to time, not that we are bad people. That doesn't really help. Above all, God has shown just how much you are loved, just how valued and special you are through Jesus. We can apologize, we can say, I'm sorry, knowing that we are still of value and loved by God. We can say, I'm sorry, because we're trying to do better in this life. We can say, I'm sorry, because we care about the other person, and we want to make sure that trust that's broken can be fixed. We can do this because there is no embarrassment in admitting that you were wrong, because all of us are going to get it wrong at some point. All of us make mistakes. You're not the only one. And we can do this because no matter what, at the end of the day, you are God's beloved child. And that will never change. Well, for this, let us pray. Loving God, we try our best, but sometimes we hurt others. Give us courage to admit when we've been in the wrong. Give us open ears and open hearts to hear from others when they've been hurt. And above all, help us to do all of these things in the knowledge that we are so deeply loved by you, at our best and at our worst, because of who you are and what you've shown through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
As we prepare for the reading of Scripture, let us pray. O Holy Spirit, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. The first reading today is the Ten Commandments from Exodus chapter 20, verses 2 to 17. Listen for God's word. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in the heavens above or the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I am the Lord your God, and I am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that your Lord God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's spouse, or male, or female slave, or ox, or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The reading from the Gospel is from John chapter 2, verses 13 to 22, in which Jesus confronts the religious marketplace within the temple. Again, listen for God's word. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. In the Presbyterian congregation where I grew up, Holy Communion was celebrated 4 times a year, and on Christmas Eve and Easter. And so it was a little bit of a change for me. In the first parish where I served, the practice was, as it is in our congregation of Wayside, the first Sunday of every month. And I think for most Presbyterian people, this has become the pattern, with Holy Communion in the place where worship happens, on the day designated for it, in the sanctuary, around the familiar table. It's a good thing, and it's important to us. And won't it be a joyous thing when we are able to do that again? But communion, the participating in the sharing of Christ's body broken and his blood poured out, is by its nature a mobile feast. And we've all seen photos of soldiers or sailors gathered with a chaplain in the field or on a ship to be nourished apart from the terrible thing they're involved in and granted grace in the midst of human brokenness in which all soldiers are enmeshed. These scenes are quite profound. Memorable communion services have happened for us on youth and other retreats, in other churches where we have visited, maybe on a hiking trail with a covenant group, by the bedside of a dying loved one, at a wedding. This feast Jesus has given us celebrates his body, this temple that is raised up and living, moving, present, profoundly powerful in all our life in the world. In the 7th chapter of the book of 2 Samuel, David, God's anointed king of Israel, is living in a nice home in Jerusalem. That God does not have a temple bothers David, who proposes to build a temple for God. But the word is given to David through the prophet Nathan, God's word, where God said, "I have not lived in a house since I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I've been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle." God's word then promises David within that covenant that David will be the house. David and David's people will be the house of God. What God brought the people of Israel up out of Egypt, they were nomads in the wilderness. And they had been a captive people who were now in need of God's shepherding presence, God's word. And so from the mountain, God sent Moses with the commandments to be the foundation upon which the life of the community was built and given shape. Dr. Sib Towner taught that the commandments, once they settled into one particular place and among a settled people, the commandments took on the nature of concrete, hard and solid boundaries, beyond which a person was deemed out of favor with God and the community. But for a people on the move, he taught, the commandments are like a picket fence, recognizing that a person or the community might be found to be outside the good and life-giving boundaries of the commandments. And the commandments stood as the least that was needed to hold people together healthily and faithfully. The commandments, then, are the basis of teaching what is most basic for life in covenant with God and upon which more fruitful and beautiful and loving life in and among the community can and will happen. The commandments are the seedbed from which the life of the community grows. As Jesus will sum up in his response to the question of what is the greatest commandment, he will say, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength," which corresponds to the first table of the commandments. And then he says, a second is like this: "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." The neighbor, which is the other people in the circle of your life. And this corresponds then to the second table of commandments. Jesus brings home the point the prophet Jeremiah makes in his God-given promise that God will take away the heart of stone and give the people a heart of flesh. Or as we sing in the hymn, "Here I am, Lord, I will take their hearts of stone and give them hearts for love alone." The commandments are solid as rock, but their application, lived out in community, calls for the warmth of humanity molded by the Spirit of God. That Spirit revealed to us in Jesus of Nazareth. In all four of the Gospels, we see Jesus in his tirade against the practices in the temple, the trade in animals for the sacrifices, the exchanging of profane money for sacred money to be given as offering. And much has been said and speculated about this and about what motivates Jesus in this way. In all the Gospels, except the Gospel of John, which we read today, Jesus overturns the tables in the temple the same week he is crucified, and it really ties the crucifixion in part to his run-in with religious authority. But in John, Jesus' tirade happens early, in the second chapter, one of the first things. And it defines Jesus as the one who questions the location of the temple in the faith of the people. Is it a place of stones in a city deemed holy? Or is the temple of God also, perhaps more importantly, somewhere else? Jesus utters what sounds like nonsense to those who are listening. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. His risen life is the temple in the world. His risen life is celebrated in church and by calendar and in habitual and defined ways, but his risen life is also to be mobile, on the road, in the streets, in the neighborhood, among those who are hungering and thirsting for what is right, taken to the suffering and struggling, causing the satisfied to look in the mirror of themselves, nourishing community to be about the life of Christ's love in our everyday. Jesus turns over the tables in the temple to break open the covenant like bread at the table, so that the Spirit of God that is within the commandments nourishes people together and then moves outward. That the love of God is nurtured, and that love for and with and among others is sought and expected and growing. On a first visit to a new mission site with a Presbyterian church and hospital in Malawi, Africa, our diverse North Carolina group came to realization about how apartheid in South Africa had played a sad role in the denominational partners we were working with. It was part of, unfortunately, their history, and it was all intertwined with how they got to be where they were and what they were doing. The effects were still there in the decades following the official end of apartheid. Well, we were staying in a guest house there, a compound for the hospital and the synod of the church. And we could now see that that had been built years earlier by Dutch Reformed Christians from South Africa. And staying in this same guest house with us was a missionary from South Africa who, over the course of the busy days of the week, we were just beginning to know. Well, as our group gathered at the end of the first week, we were prepared to celebrate Holy Communion. We were getting everything together. And the woman from South Africa asked a couple of us if she could join us and share in our worship and receive communion. She told us that she had not received communion in 7 months, even though there was a Presbyterian church in the community. Turns out she was caught in a sad dilemma. She would not permit herself to worship with the African congregation. And the congregation of other missionaries who were there under the auspices of the same church that she was, they had stated their objection to her prejudice. So she was broken from that fellowship. Our leader said that, you know, we could not endorse her prejudice, but neither could we deny her the grace of God in communion, and that she was welcome to join us. And so she did. It was very thought-provoking for all of us. We broke bread. We shared the cup. All of us in our mixed-up and disjointed trajectories. All of us on our various sides of that picket fence of the covenant of God's grace, though we were bound together in that covenant, the temple of the body of Christ, where he keeps turning over our tables. He keeps including us in his body broken and his life poured out, that by his transforming grace, the love of God will overwhelm us. We'll be called into the community of God's people. We'll be sent into the world where the temple of Christ's body will know no boundaries and will be the beacon of light for a weary world. Amen.
God's commandments help us to see what it means and what is required to live together in peace. And in Jesus Christ, we see a life lived in perfect trust and harmony with God. Let us lift up our lives, community, and world to the Lord in the hope that all of creation should be conformed to the ways and the love of God. And as I say, Lord, guide our feet, I invite you to respond and hold us in your love. Let us pray. Almighty God, you are most fully present and revealed, not in any building, but in your Son, Jesus Christ. Give us the wisdom and strength to remove any obstacles that prevent your people from experiencing your presence and grace. Lord, guide our feet and hold us in your love. Righteous God, your laws are just and rejoice the heart. May your justice revive weary souls and oppressed peoples around the world. We long for the day when your ways are valued and your peace prevails upon the earth. Lord, guide our feet and hold us in your love. Creator God, the heavens declare your glory. Train our ears to hear and value the testimony of your handiwork. Grant us open eyes and curious hearts that we may live in wonder, gratitude, and awe. Lord, guide our feet and hold us in your love. Gracious God, your steadfast love is from everlasting to everlasting. We pray that you would sustain us and those whom we love through adversity. Deliver us from all that afflicts body, mind, and soul. Lord, guide our feet and hold us in your love. Ever-living God, you raised Jesus from the dead. We entrust the dead to the one crucified for us in the hope that they would also be raised to new life in him. Lord, guide our feet and hold us in your love. We pray all of these things in the name of the one who has revealed who you are and has shown who you have created and called us to be. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are laboring in life and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. All of you, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and of humble spirit. Take my yoke upon you and find rest for your souls." Well, this is the feast table of our Lord Jesus Christ, who invites everyone to come and share in this meal that he has prepared. Come to this table, all who trust in him, regardless of your tradition in Christ, from wherever you find yourself in your journey of life and faith, come to this table of welcome and nourishment. During the ongoing pandemic, we are still separated from one another, but we are united by the Spirit of Christ and in this sacrament. You're invited to gather elements from your home, bread and juice or wine, but other common elements that you may have are good to use, for common elements are what Jesus used with his disciples. Whether you have elements or not, in this sacrament, the Spirit of Christ is with you to nourish your heart in faith. Let us be in prayer. Holy God, it is good and right to give thanks to you and to worship you. You've always been with us. Before the mountains were brought forth, or before you had formed the earth and the world, you have been God. It was your delight to create humankind, and you sought our partnership in covenant love. And in every time and season, you remained faithful, even when we were not. Even when freed from slavery by your liberating power, we sought to contain you in images of gold. Even when led and guided by you through your faithful prophets, we rejected you. We wanted a king so we could be like every other people. When all that we sought and longed for, pursuing our own ends, disappointed our prodigal spirit, you waited and watched so that in the gift of your Son, we might come to ourselves and seek to return to our place as children in your household, and coming home to you, we found the grace of your welcome. Holy God, in Jesus Christ, you break the power of sin to harm and distort all people. We lift our hearts in praise and thanks at his faithfulness in your way, how he did not turn back from the cross, but has led through the terrible power of death to your triumph in the power of life eternal. We gather at this table Christ has set, with his own body broken and his own blood poured out. And here we remember his love that has no end, his love from which we cannot be separated by anything in all of creation. Pour out your Spirit on us and on these gifts you have given, that we will be nourished to life that is eternal and abundant, and united as your people, we may more and more give witness to the risen life of Jesus, transforming this world. This we pray in your name, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, uniting our voices in the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. On the night on which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus, when he had given thanks, he took the bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, poured out in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you, in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink of this cup, We proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Join with me in the prayer after communion. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
As you are able in these times, go into the world as subject to the risen life of Jesus, as people of faith and hope and love. Be people of forgiveness and reconciliation, of encouragement and compassion, who listen with the mind of Christ, who speak the truth guided by Christ's love. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the peace and the joy of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.